As I mentioned in the beginning of the service, it's been 24 years since my dad went to be with the Lord. 24 years is an amazing journey, and I'm ever grateful for what he continues to do in the life of this ministry over these 24 years. What people felt was totally shattered, broken, and gone. God proved them wrong, because he was the one, and he is and will be the one who will lead. Hallelujah. So when he is the head and we are the different organs in the body, then we don't have anything to worry about, because he will lead and we just need to follow. I keep telling it hundreds and thousands of times. I don't mind repeating all over again that God only wants fat people. Fat not as in like me, 90 kgs. It is F that is faithful, A that is available, and T that is teachable. So if you are willing to be faithful, and if you are available, not with an asterisk mark which says conditions apply, I'm available, God, after I log out and have my lunch or dinner, and even just for an hour or maybe half an hour. Hour is also difficult. Sundays also have certain slots I can give you. Then he'll say you remain in your slot. Available is unconditional. And above all, we should be willing to be taught. And God took me through so many breaking experiences over these 24 years because of the kind of life that I lived. So to mold and make is not going to be easy, because I was patterned according to this world and the worldly thoughts. And they were part of me and the habits that I was involved in. So when I gave up drug addiction, when I gave up alcoholism, it was not like from next day morning I was jumping with joy. No, I was rolling here and there because of that excruciating pain of those withdrawal symptoms and so many other things, not just physical, but emotional turmoil because of the 4 lakh rupees debt that was sitting on our head. Oh, 24 years back, that's a lot of money. And stage by stage, year over year, God kept dealing and molding. And we can just see, not just this place, but over 2,000 people keep coming. It's amazing. In the morning, I took up a very, very practical subject. If you understand Telugu, I request you to take that 45 minutes and log into the YouTube channel sometime during next week or whenever you find time. After that, you'll forget. But one of the rarest messages I can tell you, which is very simple but profound, and it was a very practical message. A lot of people came back saying that they were really blessed and touched, and so was I. So I encourage you to listen to it. And the message today morning was about conscience. That human faculty in us, which is so important. The reason why I chose it, when I didn't give my life to the Lord and when I was living the way I wanted to live. Not that my conscience was not warning me, because I was born and brought up in a very good Christian family. So we had good Christian beliefs and good Christian values, so there was no problem. And conscience is all about our individual belief and value system. Simple. It has nothing to do with divine thing. Conscience is not divine. Conscience is simply said a human faculty. My conscience is a warning system that warns me based on what it was fed. And that is my individual belief and my individual values. And when that warning signal comes to you saying that this is right, this is wrong, you can go by saying, okay, I agree to what you're saying, or you can just ignore and do what you like. And I spoke about Paul's desire when he was standing before a council, when he was being accused of treason. Paul says in Acts 24:16, we don't have to look it up, he says, I have strived to maintain a clear conscience always before men and with God. Beautiful. I have strived to have a clear or a good conscience always before men and before God. Will you be able to say that? We are living in a world where people have different belief systems, different values. Where we work or where we live. It is only changing so much. And we should be people of good conscience. And we meditated about how can we have or develop a good conscience. So I can't give you the full message then. I might as well share that same message. But I encourage you to listen to that message. You will be edified. You will be blessed. I can tell you that. Quickly we will look at another familiar aspect of Christian life. And I was pondering around these as I was reflecting about my dad's life. Not that I remembered him only yesterday because of his 24th death anniversary. He is so much a part of my thoughts. So there will be numerous times in a day that I continue to remember him for the person that he is. Any child will be proud of their parents, so am I. Because the reason why I chose that topic in the morning was more about his strong conviction. He was just firm in what he believed. And it's amazing. And I was also thinking about how we continue to really progress in this journey. Where there were hardly any resources back then. Salaries were limited. People were limited. And there's nothing much. Now we have so much. We have the problem of plenty, not the problem of having less. Because when you walk into a supermarket, there is so much. While we want to buy one or two things, suddenly we realize we need a lot more. Actually not. That is the problem of plenty. Back then, there were only kirana stores. And we knew what to go and buy. And we had only that much of money. Even that was not sufficient. Sometimes we used to say, we'll give you next week. I mean, I'm being honest. There were times when we used to maintain one small debt register, kata, that's what they say. And then you give back that 100 rupees after a week. And now we have 3-4 credit cards, not one. If one credit card limit is over, you swipe the other one. And later on, you are caught in this debt trap. Another beautiful aspect of Christian life, or which is synonymous of the word life, is walk. You know, we use it. We call it walk of life. Yes, no? And there is only one person that should come to your mind when it comes to walking with God. Who is that? I know quizzes are not encouraged in Enoch, right? I'm sure most of you know. Just four or five verses about Enoch's life. A small summary. Nothing more was revealed. But in that small summary of 4 or 5 verses in Genesis 5, two times it is told, Enoch walked with God. Enoch walked with God. And the beauty is, he was no more. And he kept. There were only two people in the Holy Scripture who didn't see death. One was Enoch and the other was Elijah. Two people. We're not going to look at that life, but quickly, with the very limited time that we have, we'll quickly look at what does walking with God mean? We will understand practically. three broad categories. You are by now used to my style of more of teaching than preaching. But when I go out and share somewhere, you will see the preacher side of me. But pretty much Sundays, I am more in the teaching mode than in the preaching mode. Marie Antoinette, she was the last queen of France before the Great French Revolution. She was executed in the year of 1793. She was beheaded because she was found guilty of treason. And one lady by name Carolee Erickson wrote her biography called To the Scaffold, The Life of Marie. And this lady went on to describe the life of this queen, the last queen of France before French Revolution. And it was all about the way she wanted to live a glamorous life, a life of entertainment, lavishness, and so on. While France and the people of France were going through a lot of economic turmoil and they were being taxed a lot more, I cannot say like us now, it will create problems. But on one side, they are being taxed so much and they're going through so much of pain. But this queen, I believe, was always living a very lavish, flamboyant life. And finally, she was convicted, she was executed, the most horrible death. And it surprised me as I was Googling and reading, this kind of execution went on for a long time in France, I believe. That was scary. And this lady who was writing her biography was trying to look at anything positive about this queen. And finally, she discovered an interesting aspect of this queen. And the interesting aspect is, while she was always wanting to party and enjoy and do all of this, since she's a queen, she just can't go anywhere, right? People will know. So whenever she wanted to just get herself entertained, go to dances and parties and all, she used to disguise herself by masking and wearing something else and get into those parties, hoping that people will not recognize. But I believe every time she was somewhere discovered, for the simple reason that she had a unique way of walking. While she changed her attire, she changed everything. So if somebody looks at her in that disguise, nobody will recognize. But the moment she takes few steps, they know that she is the queen and she was always caught. And this is the exact verbatim from that book. It says, when she walked, she strode like a man. Her swift, purposeful gait was a trademark. It was said that she could never successfully disguise her identity at masked ball, for no matter how she dressed, she still walked like an empress. No matter however she disguised, she still walked like an empress. No matter where you are, do you still walk like a child of God? Because you are recognized, I am recognized by the walk of our life. Yes, no? It is not the words that we say, but the way we walk. Not that you wear some high heels or something and walk like a model, no. That is not walk. You all understand, I don't have to explain. How you and I carry ourselves in our day-to-day life. And Enoch had this amazing testimony that he walked with God. So keeping this broad topic or theme in mind, let us understand quickly, what does it mean when I am saying, when you are saying, when we are saying that we as children of God are walking with God? What does it mean? What does it infer? Quickly, three things, and I will wrap it up real quick. The first one is, if our life is a life that is in tune with God and if we are walking with God, it will be marked with a purpose. People who are in tune with God or in sync with God, who are in hand with God, are walking step by step alongside God. Their lives, look at any life in the Bible, or look at the great men and women of God, you will clearly see that they had a purpose. There was this great man of God, of the many. When I was a teenager, when I first had this encounter, his name was Jonathan Maharaj. Amazing man of God. And when he gave his testimony, he said when he came to know the Lord, he is from a non-Christian faith. And back then, he's from India. His family members threw him out of the house. They packed his clothes and threw his suitcase away, I believe. And he said these words which were registered in my mind. He said, when I was thrown out with my suitcase, I was thrown out on the road not knowing what to do. I picked up the suitcase. In one hand, there was the suitcase. And another hand, I placed in the hand of God. And from then till now, I am walking with him. Wow. It was powerful. He said, I kept one hand on my suitcase, one hand on God, and I kept walking. Our lives will be marked with a purpose. When we are walking with God, and when I kind of shared today, a few minutes back, as we were reflecting about my dad's demise and this 24 years, not that I was steadily walking with God. I was struggling, I was falling up and down. But since I did this huge sin of living a backslidden life, because I came to know the Lord back in 1985, and I came back to the Lord in 1995. So 10 years, it was very inconsistent. It was a backslidden life, following God at a distance. My walk was not with any specific purpose. But then after having paid a heavy price, then I realized, I understood his calling. I said, God, now I know. Now I have this clear purpose that I need to stand up and take these people across the Jordan. And these 24 years, it is based on that very verse. Irrespective of whatever we go through time and again, if there are any trying situations, I just go back to that very verse, which gives me confidence and courage and comfort. As I was with Moses, I am with you. Be of good courage. Go on. Galatians chapter 5 verse 25 says, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. And the walk, or that word walk that's mentioned here as it is on the screen. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. This walk, I believe, the original translation in Greek describes the walk of a soldier. A walk of a soldier who is all set, not just to go around and do some march past, but to get ready for the battle. And their walk will be different. Their walk will be very firm and straight and sturdy and strong. And that is the kind of walk that we need to have as children of God, that you are focused and you walk with a purpose. If you recall the incident of Jesus' resurrection, and as Jesus chose to walk alongside two disciples on the road of Emmaus, you know, they keep talking with each other. It's a long conversation, and Jesus behaves as if like a stranger who's come first time to Jerusalem, and they say, you don't know what happened. You know, they killed him and all. He said, And he slowly starts to reveal to them the scriptures, everything in that journey. It's a long walk. And then they compel him to stay in their house and have supper. And as he breaks the bread and the wine, he just disappears. And then they realize, oh. And they recall that conversation as they were walking with him. They say, didn't our hearts burn when he was speaking to us? When we walk with God, and each day, like it is in Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed or in agreement? Two people can walk together only when they agree that this is the direction that we will take. That you should go in the same direction. You should go in the same pace. And that is what God expects us. And if your life is a life that speaks of walking with God, that means your life and my life will be marked, will be clearly distinct, that it has a purpose given by Him. The first question that you need to ask yourself is, are you walking with God's purpose in mind? Have you discovered God's purpose? Have you understood God's calling? And if so, wonderful. If not, spend some time in His presence each day. And you need to be desperate to know why God has made you, for what He has made you, why He has placed you in so-and-so place at this point in time. And say, Lord, let me understand Your purpose. And when God reveals to it, be passionate to follow that purpose. It's amazing. And somebody said it beautifully. When God calls, He will provide. He will equip. There is no two ways. You don't have to doubt. And like so many characters in the Bible, look at Joseph, look at Moses, look at David, and so on and so forth. When they had this encounter with God, and especially Moses, especially, when he was 40 years old, when he was part of the kingdom of Pharaoh and was grown in that palace according to God's amazing plan. He received the best of the training, education, and everything. But then God had a different plan. God wanted him to be groomed in the wilderness. He ran away for 40 years. Think about it. For 40 years, all that he was doing is living a life of a shepherd. And then that great encounter before that burning bush, when God calls him, Moses, Moses. He keeps giving so many excuses, and God comes back to the point of His purpose, right? He says, I want you. You are going to lead. He said, who am I? It's not about who you are. It's all about who I am. What should I say? Who has sent me? The I am has sent. Go. And Moses discovered purpose. That day, he went back, led people out of Egypt. And look at the life. Look at the kind of leadership that Moses displayed. A life that resembles or is marked with a purpose. If you claim to be a child of God, if I claim to be a child of God, if I claim that I'm walking with Him each day, then may our lives be marked with a purpose. And if that is not the case, I only encourage you to seek God's forgiveness and say, God, may I be driven with that purpose. Because God's purposes are amazing. God's purposes are the best. God's will is the best. And we need to come back to that. Irrespective of whatever we are doing. And say, Lord, help me pursue Your purpose. Second one of the three. Walking with God means my life is marked with purpose. Walking with God means my life is mastered in patience. Because this is a long walk. This is not just Sunday walking to church and going back. Who is walking these days, any which ways? Even if you have a two-wheeler, it should have a self-start. You know, we don't even want to exert and start it. No. Cars also, we want it automatic. Start push button. Elevators, the moment you go, it should open. You don't even want to press anything. Tomorrow when you sit at the dining table, some machine will come and feed you. I'm sure those days will come. I'm sure there will be restaurants which will say, you don't have to have the effort of using your hands. Come and sit and have this experience of being fed by robots. They will smile, they will talk. And there is this Amazon gadget, no sir, what is that called? See, your Alexa. Small little gadget in the car. The moment you get in, it will start talking to you. You are supposed to look at and drive, no? If you keep talking, you'll go and crash. But the way it says, you know, there is some companion with you all through. It will tell you about speed, it will say you stop and all. Beautiful ad. These are the days, you know, when so much of automation is happening. And I'm part of an organization, I'm heading an organization. Like any other organization, we are also talking of AI, MI, or whatever. Not MI, ML. Agile way of working. 2 years from now, skill sets are going to... It's a reality. When when so much is changing, you are supposed to make an effort to adapt to that change. And it calls for patience. Right? I'm talking from a worldly standpoint. If you have to get to the next level, you have to spend some time. This generation doesn't understand. 1 year in the job. When will I get my next promotion? After 2 years, when will I become a manager? After 5 years, will you vacate the CEO chair? If not, I'll go and start my own company. How many entrepreneurs? Then who will buy finally? Every alternate fellow has got a startup. This fellow's life has not started, but he wants to start a startup. And this is impatience, right? But if my life speaks of walking with God, then we should understand it is not a sprint, it is a marathon. And that calls for immense patience. Our life should be mastered with patience. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 16 says that, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Circumspectly comes from two Latin words which mean look around with the idea of walking and seeing. That is how you and I are supposed to walk. And Job says, by his light I walked through darkness. Are you willing to patiently wait on the Lord and go on? Like I think last Sunday, I spoke about delay. it's not easy. When you've been waiting for a job for over a year, or you've been married and you're waiting for a child, it could be 2 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, or something else. None of us like delay because we are so used to these days that having everything on our fingertips and with so much of technology, it's all about speed. It's all about getting things faster. It's all about efficiency as we use in our office. What was done a couple of years back cannot be done the same way today. You should be more efficient. You should turn it around fast and so on and so forth. So when we hear all of these words and that is how you are accustomed to work or that is how you are accustomed at college and school when there is so much of competition, the same mindset comes into our spiritual walk and we think we are just here to finish off one race after the other. It is only one single race, a race that is a long-term race and which is patient walking. So is your life really mastered with patience? That I will keep going and doing this mundane stuff day in and day out. And the greatest strength, I took a message on this verse about you know, walking and not being tired. The greatest strength God gives, those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they will fly with wings of eagle. They will run and not be tired, and walk and not be weary. I'll quickly tell you in 2 minutes. We think the greatest strength is the strength to fly, right? Logically speaking. Yes, no? How many of you have flown and came inside? Not really, right? Literally. None of us, right? Is there anybody? Without my notice, you came flying from the main road into this? No, right? But how many of us have got into an aeroplane? I'm sure there are. Don't tell me nobody got into an aeroplane. Right? Few hands, yeah, you don't feel shy. But not everybody, right? When did we get into an aeroplane? Every time I want to go to work, huh? From Toli Toki to DLF. No, right? For most of us as middle class people, right? Unless there is some wealthy person here, meet me after church. But I mean, it's nice to be wealthy, there's nothing wrong. But most of us are from middle class families, right? And for us, now flying, air travel is kind of affordable, not all that affordable, but kind of. But 15, 20 years back, it was no way affordable for any middle class person. I don't know whether my father ever got into an aeroplane, never. So the only time we think of flying is either the distance is too long or it's an emergency. Right? And so that is exceptional cases. We will fly. And that verse tells me, when you have some exceptional situations, God will give you the strength to fly. Hallelujah. But do we need strength to fly every day? No. If every day is an emergency exception, then you are in a big problem. That means your life is a total mess. You have not managed it. It doesn't happen. Every day is not an emergency, but we will have emergencies. Maybe once a week, once a month, I don't know. Second, running. How many of you came running to this service? Unless you are late, even then you will not run. Only office we will run, or college. Right? But when will we run? When we are late. One of. Every day I don't keep running to office, and even in the office I'm running here and there. No. Right? One off. And when you need strength to run, which is also not frequent, God will give you the strength. But the beauty is that highest level of strength is the strength to walk every day. How many of you walk today? All, I am sure. There are no escalators, sir, here. At least if you came on a bike till that gate, from there till here, you walked. Right? All of us walk every day. Are you getting the point? And to go to school and college 17 years, 20 years, and to work for 20 years, and for a mother who is a housewife at home, to cook for people, 3 or 4 in the house, morning breakfast, afternoon lunch, dinner, even if you have maids, you to supervise them. And will it change every day? Same routine. Year on year. 1 year, 2 years, no, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years. That calls for a lot of strength. And God says, I will give you strength at that level. Hallelujah. To walk and not be. See, I gave another message also. So that is the beauty of following and walking with God. That God will give us the strength to keep going and doing that everyday routine. Our lives are pretty much routine. Initially, when you change a job, it will be different for probably not even 1 year actually. 2-3 months, it's exciting. Wow. Then same. Same emails. And same Excel spreadsheets with some more macros. And so on and so forth. Nothing will change. There is no drastic innovation every day. To go through that routine, a lot of people get tired. But if you are a child of God, you say, with your strength, I will go and do it all over again. And more so, in our spiritual journey, which is a lifelong walk with God, it should be mastered in patience. And the last one, and with that I close. So a walk with God, a life that is walking with God, is marked with purpose. And second, it is mastered in patience. And third, it is measured by progress. This is crucial. It is measured by progress. How many of you bicycled? Not now, when you were kids, sir. Cycle, sir. Okay. Now, this generation will not have the art of bicycling also. Right? Most of us, when we tried to bicycle, we fell many a times. Just no? Don't tell me, you know, day one I got in and, you know, then you are supernatural. Not really, right? It probably took us 1 week, 10 days, 2-3 times, down, we kept falling. But then if we realize, the only way of not falling is to continue to cycle. Yes, no? If you continue to pedal, you'll keep going. I will only fall when I stop pedaling. Right? And it's a small illustration to tell us what it means to progress. Again, some people will be bicycling round and round. Right? That is good. We should understand the difference between activity and progress. Some are, a lot of people's lives are very active, but there is no progress. It is like getting onto a bicycle and going round and round and round. Going in circles is not progress. Are you getting the point? Is your spiritual life making any progress? Or you are the same? Years together, it is the same prayer. You only know some basics in the Bible. There are 66 books, this, that. First book, last book, I know. And some people's prayer, if we record, we will think it is, I don't want to get in there. Exactly the same words, same style. It will start with my family, then my cousins in Vizag or somewhere else, and somebody in Dubai or Abu Dhabi. Then if possible, remember our neighbors. And then, in Jesus' name, amen. It is. We can record it and we don't have to ask them to pray again. Because again, next day evening, it will be the same prayer. Same style. So, exactly at some places, they go up, go down. Prayer life is active. But is there progress? Not really. When Jesus meets this person at that pool, in John chapter 5, who's been there for 38 long years, waiting for that water to be stirred, and whoever gets in the first time is healed, and 38 years, and all that Jesus does is comes and he says, do you want to get whole? He said, yes. And he says, take up your mat and walk. Rise up, take up and that is what? Make progress. Make progress. And that is what God is telling us, that we need to make progress in our Christian life. And that can be measured. Where were you last year versus this year? Where were you 2 years back versus now? Have you made progress in this journey? How is your knowledge about God? Is it much more than how it was a couple of years back? And are you understanding his purpose? So Enoch walked with God. Similarly, God wants us to walk with him. A walk that has a purpose, a walk that is patient, and a walk that has got clear direction. Let's bow our heads in prayer for the word that he gave, as he always does. Great is his faithfulness. Take a moment to introspect your very life and see how is it. Is your life marked with progress? Is your life, is a life filled with being patient? And are you progressing? And do you have purpose? And we need to be in sync with Him in our thoughts. And only then can we walk in step with Him. Gracious God, we thank and praise You for having spoken to us as You always do. Thank You for reminding us that Christian life is a life of walking with You. And that walk should have a purpose and should make progress, and we should be patient. Help us, O God, to keep walking by faith and not by sight. Walking in the Spirit, walking in the light. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.